All right, all right, all right. Welcome back to another episode of Stay Beautiful America. I'm here with Bill Squire, Cleveland legend in my book.
Hey, thanks, man.
Hey, that's what I'm here for. I'm super glad you came over today. I think this will be a fun little hour conversation together.
Am I good here?
However you feel comfortable. And first thing, I appreciate that you love Blink. We were kind of talking about it beforehand, but you just earned a lot of points in my heart because of that.
Well, growing up, you know, I was born in 82, so Blink, I remember when Damn It came out.
Yeah, of course.
And I was just like, this song fucking rules.
Yeah.
Like, that song just spoke to me immediately. That riff is so, it's simple, but it's catchy. And just like, you know, before you can even remember their name, you can just go, na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na- they released Enema of the State, and and it was like even more silliness and not taking themselves too serious, especially in that time of boy bands and new metal and stuff like that, where they are just so entrenched in like the boy bands were like for the girls and the new metals for like bros and stuff like that. And I was just like, I didn't feel like I fit into either of those. So like Blink was the one that was ripping on those. I'm like, oh, that's the one that's that me. I like. Yeah, that's what I'm into. And then they had a good evolution over the years of going from, okay, we're this silly band, but you know, we're growing up. We want to talk about some deeper stuff and get, and then, you know, kind of start a whole new movement with what having them getting a little more emo or whatever you want to call it. But like, that was always there. If you, especially if you know Tom, like he was a big, you know, like Jimmy Eat World's his favorite band, and he likes
The Cure.
He loves The Cure. So like going in that more like darker direction, like, you know, new wave type of stuff.
Yeah.
And mixing it with their music, like, it made all the sense in the world.
No, and it works so well, in my opinion. And and you mentioned the Tom, Mark, and Travis show.
Yeah,
the comedy album, but it's also, at the same time, great live music.
Great live music.
It sounds so good.
And so I got to see that when I was in like, them filming that.
Yeah.
Or, like, recording it. I don't know which, I don't know if they pulled from a bunch of different shows.
Yeah.
But I was at the one in Salt Lake City because I was raised Mormon. And so
you were allowed to go to a Blink concert as a Mormon?
Yeah, because like I mean, there was a lot of Mormons there, so like there's, you know, a lot of parents would be like, all right, fine, just go. Like they're like, they didn't love it, but they're, you know, you don't really tell your parents either. I was 18 and I live, like, my parents were in Ohio, and so I was supposed to go to the one in Cleveland too, but it was I was grounded because I didn't graduate from high school. So, and I'm like, wait a second.
That's very
like, not grounded, but my mom was like, hey, if you didn't graduate, you can't go to the Blink concert because you're supposed to be at commencement today. And she's like, you can't go to, like, you can't. And I should have just went. It would have been fine.
Nah, but you still got to see him. That's awesome.
I did get to see him. Like, so a
that
month
was,
later.
I think that was in like the year 2000.
Yeah, it was year 2000.
That is so fucking awesome.
It was great. And, Bad Religion and Phoenix TX opened up for him.
Wow.
So, like, it was just a phenomenal
show.
What
a lineup.
Yeah. So, like, and, like, seeing, like, I was very familiar with Bad Religion. Phoenix TX, because of them opening for Blink, I got into them a lot.
Yeah.
And I think it was right before they released their second album. And so they played a lot of that stuff. And it was just a great show. It was, like, it was so much fun. And they were hilarious. And the crowd was really into it. And it was just, you know. And I wore... Because this is how 2000s it was, I wore a shirt that I got from Hot Topic before Hot Topic was like
popular,
as popular as it is now. Like it was like still more of a funny T-shirt store back then, and I had a shirt that said "Spear Britney," which like people were just like, "That's the best shirt I've ever seen." I'm like, "Yeah, it's pretty funny."
But, I mean, I love Britney Spears.
Right, but it was just like
the time,
especially
awesome.
That time, like when everything was so combative on TRL, and like you're either like pop music or pop punk music. Or like rap rock, and then you know, there was no crossing.
You picked one, and you had to stay in your lane.
But you had to like be like a total fanboy for one of those.
You picked one and you rocked with it. So that, you know, obviously, I know you're on the Alan Cox show. You're a big comedian in Cleveland. You are like, and like I said, in my mind, the biggest guest I've had. not in terms of just size and presence, but just...
But also that.
Yes. I mean, you're an awesome guy. Yeah. But this is my first question. It was kind of, you know, Coley helped me with this. And shout out to Coley for getting me this interview. He's a great guy, and I appreciate the connection.
He's doing his new metal night at Foundry night. Maybe I'll pop over there.
Oh, yeah. I always... Yeah. I love that guy.
He's great. He's...
Idea man for me. Yeah. He's just constantly giving me tips and tricks. But his one question that he had for me is... to ask you, and this is good because you already mentioned it. How the hell did you go from a Mormon missionary in Utah, and how did you end up in stand-up comedy and get on a radio show? Because I feel like that's got to be the wildest journey.
So I was a Mormon missionary. Like, I grew up here. So, like, the Mormon stuff's all based, like everybody thinks I'm from Utah. I only spent, one summer in Utah.
Oh, okay, that makes sense.
But, like, I went to a mission in the Philippines. And while I was there, like, all these things started to, like, click for me. And it's funny that you bring this up right now, because I just posted one of my stand-up clips about my time in the Philippines. And it's, like, a two-part story where, like, I first just kind of talk about some silly stuff that happened there. And so all these Mormons are making it go viral. And then they're watching my next clip that I posted, because I'm like, well, I'm going to do it back-to-back.
Yeah.
Where I talk about how... it's the first place I ever had a beer. I went to a strip club.
In Utah?
No, in the Philippines.
Oh, in the Philippines.
In the Philippines as a Mormon missionary.
Oh, yeah.
And so then I got caught and excommunicated from the Mormon church. And so while I was there doing all that missionary work, you do a lot of speaking in front of people, like public speaking and teaching and stuff like that. And I was very good at coming up with lesson plans that were engaging. So whether they were funny or just... you know, like, drew you in, whatever it was, that was my favorite part. Was, like, I didn't even care about the material as much as, like, how can I make people pay attention to this?
Yes.
Because that was a creative challenge for me. And so when I got back, I was just completely, like, it's 2004. I've been gone for 2 years. I haven't really had, you don't really have any communication with people back in the States very much. So, like, I didn't really... feel like I had like a strong friend group or anything, because everybody had moved on. It's 2 years, and I got back and I was just looking for something to guide me and just in something that I can put my energy into. And within a month, I was real depressed. The first month that I was back, real depressed, just felt like I had no direction. And I saw an ad for an open mic in Medina, Ohio, where I grew up.
Oh, no way. I grew up in Akron, like Copley.
Okay, so
right, like, down 18.
Dude, my parents are on 18.
No way. By where? I mean,
like,
you don't need to get...
Like Medina Line Road. And
for sure.
But I was on Bonita by, they moved a few years ago, but, and it's not like it's a secret where they live. There's fucking sign out front, because my dad has a business.
That's cool.
So I grew up on Bonita right there by Rinky Dink, the golf course.
I used to go there all the time with my dad.
The miniature golf course, not a golf course, but So the old movie theater got turned into a performance venue in downtown Medina in the square, and they were having open mic nights every Thursday. On one Thursday, it'd be improv, and the other Thursday would be stand-up comedy. And so I went on a stand-up comedy night, because that's like, I just felt like that... First of all, it was the next one. I probably would have done improv if that had been it. But it ended up being stand-up comedy. So I was like, okay, I'll write some jokes. And I went and I told these jokes, and they were terrible.
Yeah, of course.
But it was fun. And, you know, like, there was one lady that was just carrying the whole show. She was just laughing at everything. Like, like super hard. So I was like, fuck like yeah. Like, yeah, yeah. Like, she was, and she was great. And so from there, I went and just... started hitting open mics all over the place and trying to get booked and just like totally threw myself into stand-up comedy for...
I love that.
For, you know, the next year. And within that year, I started working on the road and like getting paid. And so then I did that for about 8 years of just doing like hardcore road comedy.
Yeah.
Lived in New York for a little bit and then moved back to Cleveland and got an opportunity to be on the radio. And I was up against some other very funny people in the city that were auditioning for it as well. And I'm the one that got it. And it was And that's been 10 years now. So,
wow.
Yeah, it's, you know, that's the truncated version of it, but it's pretty cool.
No, I love that. Yeah. That's so cool. Cause I mean, Coley mentioned that to me cause obviously, like I said, we were at Corky's together and he goes, I'm going to text Bill and see if I can get him on your show. And I said, seriously?
Yeah.
And he goes, yeah. So he texted you and he goes, all right, text him right now. Here's his number.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay.
And here's the thing. I haven't even done his show.
No way.
Yeah. Cause wow. I'll do, if here's the deal. I'll make with Coley and I'll text him this. Trendkill Radio is his podcast.
Yeah, yeah.
And mine's the Bill Squire show, and we're up against each other for the Cleveland Scene Best of Awards.
Yes, I did.
Whoever loses
has to be
the other person.
Oh, that's genius.
Yeah, so
because I had Coley on my show. I've yet to be on Trendkill Radio.
Yeah.
I did Pound Cakes episode.
Yeah.
I came in the studio and we went to his little fart box, as he called
yeah.
it. Like, you know.
Yeah.
But we saw you filming and I saw Alan, and you know me, I'm just like a little nobody. I'm just like, hey, like, how are you guys?
It is cool down there though. The
That was amazing.
Yeah.
That was the first time I've been in that iHeart building.
Yeah.
I was just blown away. It's just so awesome.
It is awesome. And from where we were in Independence, we just moved to that place about a year ago, and it's just, it's cool
night
to like bring people in and be like, hey, I'm actually proud of this space.
Yes.
And it's not like the other place wasn't cool. It just was like between COVID and it just got a little shabby looking.
Yeah.
And so now it's really cool to bring somebody in and be like, hey, this is pretty badass, isn't it?
Yeah, no, all the pictures from like the different concerts, the iHeart, just everything, how it was laid out.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I wanted to come in and like kind of check out like Alan Cox studio, but I knew at the same time, like, you guys were in the middle of shit. But Pound Cake's a great guy. I always just, I can't believe he, you know, he went out and helped me like that and came on. And
he's a good dude. He's a funny dude. And like my biggest thing with him is like, I just want him to start applying himself more, because it's like his podcast is funny and
he's great,
but he's just a little burnt out. And that's the tough thing with this business is, you know, it doesn't pay great, especially at the level that he's at. So he's got to work this day job. And so I get by the time he's done, like, you know, it's a lot. So you got to kind of compartmentalize what you're going to really focus on. But the dude is funny as fuck.
And hilarious.
Interesting. And then also one of the best things about him is when he does have passion for something, he knows it inside and out.
Oh, without a doubt.
But when he doesn't, no idea what's going on.
The baseball bit. Bro, I was fucking dying. What did he say? Like,
we're asking him all the positions on a baseball field, and he couldn't remember center fielder, so he called it independent fielder.
Yes.
And then he couldn't remember shortstop, and he called it line drive Peter.
Yeah, line drive Peter, bro. I was like, you couldn't make this shit up.
Because he was trying to say fielder, but he just kind of like mumbled it. I'm like, did you say line drive Peter?
And he definitely said that.
Yeah, I was like, dude.
That was, I literally saw that video, and I cackled in my bedroom. Leo was looking at me like, what? Like, I startled him, but I was like, no fucking way.
Yeah.
But, okay, so I don't want to, like I said, I don't want to talk too much about Alan Cox or the radio or stand-up, because you do that all the time.
Right.
But I got some good questions here for you. I think the first one, because it's a Saturday in Cleveland today.
Yeah.
What would be your ultimate Cleveland Saturday?
I think, like,
what would you, if you had a whole free Saturday to do whatever you want, and say the weather is just like this.
Just like today?
Yes.
I think the perfect.
What would you want to do?
All right, here's the perfect thing I'd want to do on Saturday in Cleveland. First thing I'd want to do is just, like, get up and go to, you know, Edgewater or the Metro Parks and just go for a walk with my dog. Just get, you know.
Perfect.
Perfect little thing. You know, it's low stress, very relaxing.
Yeah.
And then next is what I'm going to do as soon as we're done with this podcast is go down to my pool and hang out there and have a couple drinks.
You have a pool?
I live in a condo, so.
Oh,
like,
okay,
I'm
like
good,
HOA. Like,
yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, so go hang out at the pool for a few hours, get some sun, have some drinks, listen to some music. And then, and this is honestly what I might do tonight, then go to a Guardians game. Hang out there.
Yeah.
Get some food at the, you know,
at
the stadium. And then after that, maybe go to a bar, whether, like, you know, Coley's got
New Metal Night.
The New Metal Night at the Foundry. Pants from my podcast has got his bar, Old 86. So I'd probably end up at one of those places and then call it a night around, you know, midnight, 1 o'clock. I'm not going to shut down bars. I'm too old for that.
I try not to do that either. If I'm home by 12:30 or 1, like, I'm a happy guy.
Yeah. But, you know, just kind of like a nice day of just enjoying what the city has to offer. And, you know, going to a Guardians game, even when they're not good, it's still fun. It's a great time.
I love going to games. Yeah. I'm not a huge sports. Like, I like sports. I know the positions. Like, I'm all about it.
Yeah.
But my life doesn't depend on it. My happiness doesn't.
And that's a good place to be.
Yeah.
Like where it's a pastime. It's not your life. And there's a lot of people that they make
sports their
personality.
And it's overwhelming.
It is. And what's overwhelming about it to me is you're making something that you don't really have control over.
None.
This thing that's super important to you.
And it's dictating your life.
Yeah. And
I don't get it.
And you're like, not just your, like your actual
how
happiness.
You feel. Yes. Your happiness is depending on how your team performs.
And I can't do that.
Sense.
Like, I love the Cavs.
Yeah.
I love the Guardians. I made a switch in football when they got Deshaun Watson. Cause I just felt like if you still cheer for the Browns, I totally get it. It's ingrained in people. But like, for me, I was like, I can't cheer for that guy. There's too many question marks. It felt grody, but I still love football. But now I get to enjoy football in a new way.
Where I just watch the games.
And
you just want to see a good game.
Yeah, and like I've adopted like the Chargers as my team, but not like
powder blue.
Yeah, and it's mostly for that. Yeah,
they got great unis.
And also, they got great unis. Their social media team's fucking hilarious.
Yes, they have a killer team.
And like I've always had an infatuation with Southern California.
Yeah,
San Diego more than
San Diego. I hate that they moved out.
Yeah, me too.
The San Diego Chargers, LaDainian Tomlinson, Antonio Gates back in the day. The powder blues.
Yeah.
But
even that dark blue, like that mint blue that they wore is fucking good
hard.
Too.
With the white helmet.
Yeah.
Oh.
So good. So
jizz
like,
in my pants.
Yeah.
Dude.
And like, you know, the love of Blink in South, like LA and like Southern California pop punk is, you know, that was my coming of age music.
Yeah, for
sure. I was like, that seems like a good team for me because I couldn't go. Someone in
the AFC North.
AFC North, or like even even the Bills seems like a little too on the nose.
Yeah,
I thought about the Lions, but I'm like, I don't want to be friends with people from Detroit. We're enemies.
Yeah,
like, I can't be like I like the Lions, but fuck the Pistons. Like,
yeah,
that doesn't make sense. And also, I feel like the Chargers need it. Like,
yeah, they do.
They don't have a huge fan base
compared to
some of the other teams. So
I know a lot of their games. Yeah. When you see the stadium, it's usually 50-50
yeah,
with the fans.
Right.
Like, fans are half away team and half home team. I always root for the Commanders. The Redskins was my favorite. Like when I was like 13 to maybe 18, I was that guy where my happiness depended on their success.
Right.
And guess who didn't succeed much?
Not at all. Especially in that era.
Yeah,
that
with Dan Snyder.
We
had some players like Sean Taylor, RIP, my all time favorite. But like I rooted for that team because it was my grandpa's team.
Oh, that's cool.
So, like, I have all of his memorabilia, and, like, I used to have a whole fucking, like, basement and room, like, filled with it. And I loved it, and I still root for him. But, like, now that Dan Snyder's gone, I might give them a chance again.
Again, you're right.
I like the name the football team.
Yeah.
I think the Commanders is absolutely just Swiss fucking cheese.
Like, I agree.
It's terrible. It sounds like a high school football team.
But it doesn't even sound like a football
team.
No,
and the logo is terrible.
Yeah.
Like, it's all just bad.
There was not enough. And I think I think that's more Dan Snyder.
Oh, it's 100%.
Because he's like, he didn't want to shell out for something good.
No, he 100% did.
And he could have done something really cool, even if, like, you know, like the Warriors. There's so many different directions they could have gone.
Yeah.
That would have been a tribute to the original name, but without being...
Yeah, insensitive and racist.
Insensitive, and racist.
I mean, I completely wasn't against the name change.
Yeah.
I understand it needed
right.
to happen, but, like, with what you settled on, like... Should have just kept the fucking football team.
Yeah.
Like,
well, it was actually pretty hard.
It did.
The Washington
it
football team was fucking great.
I can get behind this. Like,
because it makes it more like a soccer club.
Yeah.
Which is like Cincinnati FC is a fucking great name.
Yeah, exactly.
So, like, Washington FC, like.
That fucks.
Yeah, that's great. Like, yeah, that's fucking.
So, it's just, you know, I think that was just so ironic that you mentioned, like, well, I'm going to root for the Chargers. And I was I can get behind that.
I guess we'd be Washington FT. Football team.
Yeah.
But I think they should have just stuck with that. Because it was, people were into it.
I have a shirt. It just says the Washington football team. And I'm like, I'm about this.
There's something about the simplicity of it that just kind of breaks down all the silliness of being that into sports.
Yeah.
Like, we are cheering for a football team.
Yeah, we're rooting for the football team.
We are not Redskins. We are not Browns. We are not Chargers. We are fans watching it. Buying a product.
I remember when I went the last football game I went to with my dad, it was back in the COVID season. I think it was 2020. Mm-hmm. And it was the football team and the Browns in Cleveland.
Yeah.
And I just remember we took a really nice photo, and the caption was "Go football team."
Nice.
Like, you know, it used to be "Hail to the Redskins," like HTTR, but well, what do you say now? Like, "Go football team."
Go football team.
So no, that's so fucking funny.
Yeah.
I have another good one here for you. I think you'll like this. Okay. What are your thoughts on Helen Keller? I think Helen Keller is a myth. I think she's a mythological creature. I think everything they talk about with her isn't real. I think it's, how is someone who is blind and deaf?
Yeah.
How do you learn a language? How? I don't think it's real.
Well, I mean, the language that they learned, if you watch, also, she learned it, but who's the lady that taught it to her? Because, like, that's the miracle worker, right? That's the movie that I remember they made us watch.
There's a movie about it?
Yeah, it's an old, like, black and white movie, and it's about the lady that taught Helen Keller. Because in the movie, it's just this, like, 12-year-old girl that is Helen Keller, just, she's a spaz because she can't hear anything and she can't see anything, so everything seems scary as fuck to her.
I mean, why wouldn't it be?
Yeah. And then finally this lady, which I don't even remember her name, should know it, but she taught Helen Keller how to communicate by, like, doing, like, signs in her hand. And
that's good to know. Yeah, because I thought all of this was just made up.
No, it's really not. It's really not. A lot of the jokes are, so I'm going to take the opposite stance and say Helen Keller is real and that she did some cool shit. Cause once she learned how to communicate, she was able to do all this stuff that she did. Now, do I know exactly what she did? Not really, but you know, she overcame some adversity, and whenever you overcome adversity, the legend definitely outdoes the actual person. You know, we put these people on a pedestal and make them into almost perfect people when she probably still did some shitty things. But, we give her a pass because she also had a really tough time for a long time. And, like, having to learn to talk with your hands into somebody else's hands, that's not, you know.
Yeah.
That's not anybody's favorite thing to do.
You think she got laid?
Of course. Yeah. Like, I don't know if a blind, like...
Would you fuck a blind and deaf person? Because I don't know if I could.
Oh, yeah. You wouldn't? I wouldn't, you. Like, if they're, like, down with it, yeah. I mean, like... first of all, their throat game's going to be incredible because they're not using those vocal cords. They're just doing it with reckless abandon.
Yeah. Nice blink reference.
Yeah, and I think they also probably want to die a little bit, so they don't mind choking.
God.
If this is how I die, this is how I die.
Oh my god. Like, they're bent over the bed, head like this, and they're just like, come on. just keep smashing away.
Right, that's the one part that'd be a drawback, is like to just keep signing into their hand to tell them, what's happening next.
My god.
So I would do it. I'd fuck Helen Keller.
I didn't think this topic would be as good as it was, but god damn it, that was amazing. Okay. Here's another good one here. Outside of the podcast that you do, the radio and the stand up, who is Bill Squire outside of all that? Like, what are your hobbies? What do you like to do for fun?
Collect records, shoes, and
I didn't notice your kicks. Those are nice.
Yeah, I got a lot of shoes. I love vinyl, and I love consuming comedy.
Yeah,
I like TV and movies and stuff like that, but, like, generally I like funny stuff. So like, I really gravitate towards anything that's going to make me laugh. Like the show I Think You Should Leave on Netflix.
Oh,
like,
I watched that. That was so cringy and awkward.
Dude, it's so cringy. I loved it. The more you watch it, the funnier it gets. Yeah. And then all the memes that come from it are just, it's just so much fun. So I love stuff like that. And then my dog, like just being a dog dad.
Yeah.
And then my, you know, my kids and all that. Like I got plenty going on in my life, but mostly just like, I'd say like the biggest thing is just hanging out with friends. Like yeah. I like having a good time. So like, I got my pool in my building. So having friends over to come swim, like that's a great time. Perfect. For me. I got a pool table in my house. Come over and play some pool, or let's go out to a bar. Like, so that's like, as much as I do compartmentalize where I like my alone time.
Yeah, for sure. That's
why.
But
some people don't. Some people don't appreciate alone, and they get too. They don't understand the difference between loneliness and being alone.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of people that are in relationships and they're lonely. You don't need a relationship to feel like you have people that care about you. And when you recognize that, it frees up the world
so much.
And
I've been single over the last 7-8 years, so I know,
dude, it's fantastic, right? Yeah,
honestly, dude,
that's what I need to do. I need to stay single for a long time.
It's been amazing.
I've been like a year and a half tops.
I love it because I know I can do whatever the fuck I want when I want, and I think that's the best part. But like, I still have that perfect balance where, like, okay, like typically Sunday night through Tuesday night, that's Scott time. Like, yeah. I'm chilling by myself. I'm going to do my things. Like, I'm going to go to the gym. I'm going to do whatever I need to do.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to go out of my way to hang out with people. I don't really want, like, yeah. I just want that 72 hours for myself.
Right.
Come Wednesday, I'm like getting the itch. Like, okay, like, let's go see some people. Like, yeah. Who are we going to meet up with? Like, and whether it be, you know, go out for a drink or do whatever. Like,
yeah.
That's when I'm like, okay, Wednesday through Saturday, like, let's hang out and see as many different people and be like the friendly guy that I am. But I need that alone time.
Let me ask you this, Scott.
Yeah.
I got questions now.
Yeah.
Are you fucking though? Like, you getting out there?
Yeah, every now and then.
Do you have like a roster, or you just gotta find like a new?
No, I'm not good at that. Like, yeah. I like talking to people. Uh-huh. Like, I have.
Because you're like a handsome dude and you're in good shape. Thanks. Like, so like, and then you also have like a good job. Like, your house is nice. Like, you have.
I'm checking boxes.
You're checking a lot of boxes.
Funny that you say that.
And so, like, I can see, but it's also, if you've been single for 7 or 8 years, you have to be pretty strategic, because I'm sure there's girls that would love to be like, oh, I want to get in on this. It's all set up already.
Yes.
And I can just, and so you have to keep those boundaries. The boundaries in place where you go, okay, I'm like, this is what I'm looking for. Yes. Just a good time. Not a long time.
I've had to make that clear, and
it blows people's minds.
Oh, without a doubt. But the other problem is though, like, I have no problems. I'm fucking weird. Like,
yeah.
I'm out there. I'm social. I'm friendly. Some of my best friends are old people.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I'm not a normal 30-year-old guy in that sense. Like, from the outside, if you don't talk to me, you don't know who I am, just from, you know, if you see it, you're like, oh, okay. But you get to know me and you're like, this guy's weird.
Yeah.
I went on a date on Tuesday, thought it went really well. We went to Georgetown Vosh, and it was like happy hour on the patio, so some apps and drinks.
Yeah.
Afterwards, we went to Mitchell's Ice Cream, split three.
Killing it.
Perfect date.
Yeah.
I thought I was funny. I thought it was a good balance of conversation. Didn't talk too much about like Stay Beautiful America.
Right.
Like, I just wanted her to know who I was. And like, she was getting ready to drop me off back at my bike because she drove there. And I was like, hey, I'd love to go out again. Like, let me know what you think. She didn't really say anything. And so like, I knew at that point, like, I rode my bike home and I got a text and was like, I don't really see a romantic connection with you. Mm-hmm. And I was like, we didn't even make out. Like, we didn't do anything. What do you mean? Like, I just thought we clicked. But it is what it is. Like, I mean, I've still definitely had my fair share of like one night stands and like all that shit. But I don't like try to force anything.
No, and that's the key, is to not force it. And this is something, like, if I was going to give advice to somebody that's trying to be like a single young man that does, you know, get to hook up, but not like, you're not looking for a relationship. You're not looking to start a family or anything like that.
No.
But you want women to be interested in you.
Yeah.
The best thing you can do is every time you like, you're like, I don't want to make my bed. But you got to go, oh,
I make my bed every morning.
And I just started kind of doing it again. And I'll go, okay, I'll make my bed, because what if someone comes over?
Exactly.
And then you let it leave your mind. You don't even think about, like, you go, you don't go, I'm going to have
something. No, you just,
you just go, I'm going to do it because what if?
Yes.
And so you let these what ifs make you into a better person.
Yes.
But then it's not your driving force.
Not
because
at all.
There's so many dudes out there that are so
thirsty
and so, like, they're like
dead set, yeah, on it.
We went out to dinner and it was a perfect date and it, like, I thought we were going to hook, but it you can't.
Nah.
You can't want it too bad.
I had no intention of, like, hooking up with the chick. Yeah. I just thought she was really nice, very attractive.
Right.
I thought, like, she had a lot of boxes that were checked off.
Yeah.
Good job. She seemed down to earth, very relatable, mm-hmm. not like, you know. So I was, like, into her.
Yeah.
But the only thing that, I don't want to call it a red flag, but she was like, she told me she goes to church by herself. And I'm like, ugh. Like, she goes, what religion are you? And I go, I don't really have one.
Yeah.
Like, I go, my religion.
Well, that was the big thing then. That's probably why she,
yeah.
Because she's looking for a husband.
I thought, I mean, I would consider her as potential prospect, but we got to keep going out for that.
Right. But if she's going to have, like, she wants.
Yeah, I know.
That belief says, which is good in a way.
Well, I mean, I told her my religion. Yeah. I told her my Scott beliefs.
Yeah.
The core three values. Treat others the way you want to be treated.
Love it.
Don't be an asshole. Like,
kind of same thing, but yeah.
But, you know, just yeah. really.
Wait, what's the third one?
Karma.
Okay.
It's real. You know,
yeah.
Like, don't, you know, again, it all comes down
to. Now, are you talking about the more societal karma now that. Because it's. Karma is actually the reward after you die.
Oh, no. And I don't.
Then there's the My Name is Earl karma.
Yes.
Where it's like, do good things happen.
Yes. Kind of thing. That's my philosophy.
Yeah.
And I don't expect the good things to happen back. I just want to be, that guy when you walk away from the conversation, you think, that was a nice guy.
Right. And
like,
I love
that. That's it. That's all I want. Like,
that's, man, I wish more people had that kind of thing because there's a lot of people now, they love to be the person that thinks, like, oh, I'm going to be brutally honest. I'm going to be, you know, if you can't handle it, that's your problem. And when you
fuck that,
because you're
being
an asshole because you are afraid to actually just be nice because you take things too personally.
Yeah.
And you're insecure. Like, that's when anybody is that much of an asshole on purpose. I'm like, oh, you're just really insecure.
Yeah,
like,
it's not. You hate yourself.
Yeah. It's like you so. There's no downside to just being kind.
No,
like,
none whatsoever. And it doesn't take any effort.
Right.
Smiling at someone.
And it feels great.
Oh, it really
does.
It
feels great. When you just do something nice because that's what you want to do.
Yeah.
And you're not expecting anything.
Even if it's the littlest thing.
Any like, even the kind of karma you're talking about, you're not doing the nice thing because you want a reward. You
do
it because the reward is doing the kind thing.
Yes.
And so it's, you know, there's a lot of people that they want everything to be kind of transactional, or I go over this with my daughter a lot because she is the type of mindset where she wants there to be justice and everything to be fair for everything you do. And I'm like, you can't live your life that way because it's just not how it works. But just being kind and being nice and treating people how you want to be treated goes so far. It goes so far, and it just it takes away so much anxiety and so much stress. And with anxiety being such a topic these days, I think that's one thing that's helped me is when, you know, I used to have a more transactional approach to things. And then when I got over that and I was just like, I want to do things because I want to do things and, you know, have that freedom as well. It just changed my whole life.
Yeah, no, I 100%. Like, right. For me, like, some of the smallest things that I love. Like, I ride my bike all around town. Mm-hmm. I'm jamming out. I'm air drumming. I'm singing songs. I'm singing Blink.
Yeah.
I'm singing everything. And I see when people, like, I point at people. I jam out to them. And, like, and I tell, or if I see someone wearing, like, a cool outfit or a cool shirt, I'm like, oh, I love the dress. And, like, I just keep riding.
Yeah.
But you could see they smiled.
Yeah.
And, like, they kind of chuckle to themselves because they're like, who's this goofy fucking guy?
I did that exact same thing. On the way here, there was a dude, like, black dude. He was in, like, this black tuxedo. He looked fucking great. He had a big fro, and he was his buddy was taking a picture of him in front of a brick wall.
Yeah.
So he's doing something, and I just rolled down my window, and I was like, fire.
Yes.
Just fucking, this 100%. Looks great. And they were just like,
they smiled and they laughed.
Yeah, and I'm
but like,
like,
that shit right there goes a long way, because, like, you know, you're just making someone's day.
Yeah. Because, and also, like, when you do stuff like that, you might feel a little bit insecure, but I'm like, no, man, I see you doing stuff.
Do it. Own it.
Do some fun stuff. Have a good time. Live your life. Yeah. I don't know. If people are so in their heads about what people think about them, what they think about people, and when you kind of get down to a live in the moment type of attitude and just like, I know I'm going to be nice.
Always.
It changes everything. It's like the people that go to restaurants and they're always looking to complain.
And I'm like, why are you here?
Yeah, why?
I used to cook for yourself if you like to complain.
I worked at the Chili's.
I worked at the Pepper for 7 years. Fucking no serving inside and out.
And I've never heard somebody call it the Pepper.
I'm a Pepper Pal, baby.
Is that like a thing or
Sizzle Stars and Pepper Pals.
Oh, I love it.
So I remember, though, there was times where some of these people would keep coming back and they would complain every time. Yeah. And I would just be like, go the fuck home.
Right.
Like, quit coming here. If you're going to bitch and moan every single time, but yet you still request me and you want me to wait on. It was just like.
And for a selfish reason, please stop complaining and making these servers and bartenders' lives hard when you're going to bars and restaurants, because those are the women that I'm gonna hook up with, and then I gotta listen to them complain.
Honestly,
and so you're making my life harder.
Bartenders are some good fucks.
Oh, I know. Like, if you look at my CV, like it's a lot of bartenders.
What was that CV?
CV, like my resume. Oh, yeah. Like all my exes are pretty much bartenders to the point where like I'm trying not to. Because they're just the ones that are up when I'm
my schedule compatible.
Our schedules kind of line up.
We were talking about that. Like, the best hookups and the best people that you want to get with are compatible with your schedule.
Yep.
So it makes complete sense.
Because especially like weekends, I'm usually doing stand up or I got something going on. And that's usually when they're working. So like if we can hang out like Sundays and Mondays, I'm like, I'm free those days. Let's do it.
That's amazing.
I mean, I got work on Monday, but it's like I'm done by 6 and that's when they wake up. So
right. Because they went to bed at like 4 a.m. Mm-hmm. from Sunday night. Mm-hmm.
So. Yeah, I think being kind is just the best thing you can do. And people, like, and I get there, people have trauma and stuff like that, but it should be like a focus to just, you know, like try it more. Try being nice. Yeah.
That's our suggestion for you.
Try being nice.
Don't be an asshole.
Yeah.
Anyway, dude. I love you already.
Like, dude, we're friends now.
Yeah, like, we are friends. I think so. Yeah. Like, especially after this, 20 minutes or so? Yeah. I had this other one come up here. This is a fun one because I thought about this for a while. Okay, your ultimate day out eating. You can eat.
Okay,
you get 5 meals. You can space them out however you want, but you have a 24-hour time period.
All right, 5 meals.
So I call it the ultimate pig out, and I'll give you a little, like, just to let you think for a second, I'll tell you mine because I planned this out. So for me, I'm going to wake up, I'm going to go to the gym at like 8 o'clock, I'm going to get home by 10:30, going to Chipotle right when they open at 11, big-ass Chipotle bowl, double brown rice, black beans, all the fixings, hook up. And then about, I'd say, 1:30, 2 o'clock, we're going to head over to Swenson's.
Yeah.
We're going to get a galley boy, maybe a double cheeseburger, everything, ketchup, lettuce, tomato, like the whole, like, and maybe some potato teasers. I'll hold off on the milkshake because I like ice cream a lot, but milkshakes just make me shit myself.
Yeah.
I think it's because the actual milk in it.
Yeah, right.
About 4 or 5 o'clock, we're going to go to the Pepper. I'm getting some honey chipotle crispers at Chili's. So then that's meal number 3. Then we're going to head back to Lakewood around maybe like 7 or 8 o'clock. We're going to go to Greek Village Grill.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Get a super gyro.
Yeah.
The one that's got like all 3 meats on it.
Yeah.
At that point, I'm going to be ready to hit the town and go out for some drinks.
Yeah.
But by like 11:30, we're going to end the night at my friend's, the, you know, drunk breakfast food, get some chocolate chip pancakes, maybe some eggs, bacon, an omelet or something.
Yeah.
And that would be my feast.
I love that.
And I think I actually want to try this and like document it and make like a video. Yeah. Like, you know,
you should. That sounds like a great day. And like, it's not too overboard, but like it's, you know, you're definitely.
Oh, I'm doing the most. Doing,
6,000 calories.
Oh, without a doubt.
Without a doubt. All right. So I'll do leg day. Just to really make sure I moved a lot of weight so I can, you know, earn these calories a little bit. And then I'm going to do, after I get out of the gym, I'm going to probably around like 10:30, 11 o'clock. I'm going to get sushi.
Oh.
I love sushi.
Me too. So where's your favorite place to get it?
Blue in, I don't even know if they'd be open at that time, but for this situation, yeah, just, opening special for me.
Yeah.
It's in Crocker Park.
Oh, okay.
It's fantastic.
How many rolls can you put down?
I mean, I can put down
fresh,
a lot.
Fresh.
Like fresh, I could put down probably.
Like 30 pieces?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Easy. But I'm going to hold back. I'm going to get like, because I love tuna and salmon. So
yeah, salmon's my favorite.
I'm
going to
probably get a nice spicy tuna and a nice spicy salmon and not go crazy.
Yeah, yeah. We got a long day. We got four more meals.
Maybe a little bit of edamame on the side.
Salty.
Yeah, salty and get a little protein from it. And, you know, then, so that's going to be the next thing. The first thing, around 2 o'clock, we're going to get some, you know, let's make it 1 o'clock. And this is a Sunday, so we're going to watch football and eat some buffalo wings. Probably.
Where's your favorite place to get wings? Oh, I've done a lot of wing reviews, so I like that you said that.
Good Company.
Oh, I had them.
Those are great.
They were. I like how they gave you a complimentary wing if it was your first time there. Yeah. It was that garlic parm.
Yeah.
That was good.
So either Good Company or...
They had like the fall off the bone meat too. Sorry.
Same. Good Company and High and Dry both have
wings. High and Dry's got good wings? So I've never had theirs.
They're good.
Okay. I'll have to put that on my list.
So if I'm watching football, probably High and Dry.
Yeah.
Get some wings there. Watch the game. 4 o'clock. We are, we've had some wings, we've had some drinks. Yeah, this is first dinner. We're getting some pizza, but I don't want to go crazy with pizza because it's a lot. But
where are you getting the pizza?
I'm getting the pizza from Ohio Pie.
Oh,
have you had Ohio Pie?
Great fucking pie!
It's my
fucking good.
It's so goddamn good.
Oh, it really is.
So I'm getting
is.
The heart burner.
Yeah, I was about to say.
Just like the pepperoni, just pepperoni on pepperoni, and it's so goddamn good. Maybe get a little hot honey on the side to dip it. Oh,
you're speaking my fucking language, Bill.
So what is that? Three? That's three.
So what's your second dinner?
My second dinner, I think we're gonna get a burger.
Oh,
I love a good burger.
Where at?
Let me think. Where's a good place to get a burger? That's when we're gonna go to Good Company.
Oh, you're going back? So you're gonna get wings at High and Dry.
Get wings at High and Dry, and then go to Good Company for their burger.
I heard good things about that as well.
Their food is fantastic.
And have you had their boozy milkshakes?
Yes.
Dude, I only had the one. It was like the strawberry cheesecake.
I had I was there when they had the Shamrock Shake. So it was like a boozy Shamrock Shake, and it was fucking inspired.
Oh, my
God. Yeah.
Like minty?
Will, great job, bud. Yeah, it was like minty. I can't remember what all the flavors worked perfect. It
Dude,
was great.
Yeah.
And
you actually tasted a little bit of alcohol.
Yeah.
I was surprised. I thought it was going to be all fluff and no show.
It's good stuff. All right, so that's fourth.
So we got sushi, wings, pizza, burger.
Yeah, we're closing things out.
Yeah, what are you ending it with?
I think we're gonna go Mexican food.
Oh,
we're gonna go Cilantro Taqueria.
Oh, nice choice.
Yeah, and
is that the one on? There's a lot of them.
There's two that I know. There's one on
Detroit.
In Detroit,
that used to be the John's Diner.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, but instead of that place, I think we're gonna go to what's the one that I just had in my brain? Oh, the La Plaza,
right by here.
Yeah, right around the corner from here, and we're just gonna get some tacos and some just everything. We're gonna get tacos, burrito. Like it's the last meal of the day.
Yeah,
we're going for everything. We're getting some nachos. We're going
chips and salsa.
We're going nuts and just getting all the Mexican food that we can to just. A tostada, is that what they call it? Where it's like on a bun.
Yeah, all of those.
Ooh, fuck. That's getting me.
I know.
Excited.
I haven't eaten today.
Yeah, I don't
either. I'm like fucking hungry now after all this.
Yeah. So we'll go sushi, wings, pizza, burger, Mexican. And I wanted to put Chinese food in there.
I thought about it too because I love Panda Walk over on 117.
That place is great.
They are, but at the same time, like. It just
doesn't reach the level.
Because
you're getting a lot of the flavors you're getting from those in, like, you know, from sushi or from...
Yeah.
You know, it's like all the umami stuff. Yeah, it's all in bulk. Like, it's great stuff. I love good Chinese food.
If I could have, like, a plate, just one singular plate of chicken, noodles, and rice, sign me up. But the problem with Chinese food is like, I saw this bit, the stand-up bit about it, where this guy was like, I have a love-hate relationship with Chinese food, because when you eat it, you're never full. But then when you do get full, 20 minutes later, you're like, oh, I could eat some more of this.
Like, yeah, I mean, that's like the trope about it.
Oh,
yeah,
it's and so the dude was like a stand-up comedian. He was talking about going to the buffet.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, well, my problem at the buffet is like, I spend way too much time there. Like, you know, I'm there for 4 hours and, you know, I sit for 20 minutes and then I'm ready to eat again. Yeah. And it's just like, because when I go to the Panda Walk, I usually get like a large general, or I get the General Tso's chicken fried rice combo, and then I get a large veggie lo mein. And usually you would think that's like two meals.
Yeah.
Sometimes I eat all of that within 4 hours. Yeah. Just like,
because you just kind of keep going back and picking at it.
You keep grazing. Yeah. You know, you make a plate here. Okay, I'll make another small plate.
Right.
And then you realize you go back for the last time and you're like, this is almost empty. Like, how did I eat all this?
Awesome. I'm crazy. I can't believe I didn't put barbecue in there somewhere.
Oh, where else do you like? Where do you like barbecue?
Woodstock.
Yeah, I was about to say
Woodstock's great. There's a new place that's just opening.
I saw that. What's it called?
Wilson's.
Yes,
or something?
Yes, and it's in Lakewood.
And he was a football player.
And then
I think he played collegiately, and now he's doing barbecue. And then there's so many good open pit. On the east side.
Have you been to Proper Pig at all?
Yeah, I like that place.
Is it good?
Yeah, I like it. Yeah.
They do
a beef rib there where it's like the looks like a dinosaur bone.
Oh wow.
Dude, it's incredible. I think they do those on Thursday the last time. Good. I haven't been there in a while, but it's incredible.
Have you had XYZ Tavern?
Yes.
They're on Thursdays, I think it is. They have the like $10.99 meal where you get a meat, a sop, two sides.
Yeah.
And their chicken, like with their barbecue sauce, was amazing. Yeah. I had the ribs. I think they had pulled pork too.
Nice.
But I always really liked that place.
And I love barbecue, and it's
what's your favorite kind of sauce?
I like a sweet and spicy barbecue sauce. Yeah.
I love a Carolina. I love
the Carolina mustard.
But I do love a hot and like a sweet spicy. Like, give me that tang. Give me a bite.
And I don't want it to like set my mouth on fire.
No.
I'm not trying to
start
sweating.
Just give me a little bite.
Yeah, a little oomph. So yeah, that's my go-to. But I remember, but also like a good, just regular like honey barbecue sauce is real fucking good too.
Yeah.
The mustard barbecue sauce is like, I don't even think I knew about those until maybe 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And then I was just like, oh, this is incredible.
Have you ever had Old Carolina?
Yeah.
There was one by my mom's house.
That place is good for chain restaurant.
No,
it's
good.
Great.
It comes to play, because there was one right by my mom's. So me and her and my dad used to get that when we'd have like our Sunday family dinner.
Yeah.
Occasionally pick that up. And that's where I met the mustard barbecue.
Yeah.
But that's where I was like, damn, this is pretty good. Yeah. Like, no, I like that.
Yeah, me too.
Well, I'm not going to keep you forever, but I already feel like, you know, I'm going to message you and be like, can we be friends? And
yeah, dude, we can definitely hang out. Yeah.
My last question I asked.
Well, if you're going to Coley's thing tonight, I'll probably just see you there.
Yeah, let's do it. I'll be on my bike. I'll be riding around town.
Yeah, it's walking distance for me, so I'll just walk over.
Well,
I'm at Edgewater, so it's.
Yeah, like, I was about to say, don't tell me your address, but you live in Lakewood then. Last one then. So I always ask this to all my guests because it just. You already mentioned it, so I'm going to follow up with it. Favorite album and favorite movie of all time?
Okay. Favorite movie of all time, Jurassic Park.
Really?
Yeah. It's the movie that I remember seeing in theaters and being so engrossed by the movie that it made me believe that like you can tell these stories and really affect people. So I know a lot of people had that with Spielberg movies like Jaws and E.T., but that's the first one. Like, and I liked movies before that, but I just remember walking out of that movie. I'm like, man, dinosaurs are real now. Even though they're not. Like, I knew they weren't. I knew it was CGI. But it just felt so real and so intense. I was like, this is amazing.
That's awesome.
So I love that movie. It's a perfect adventure film. It's a little bit scary. It gets you all worked up. It's got some good jokes in it. It's just a perfect movie. And then my favorite album of all time is Coheed and Cambria and Keeping Secrets of Silent Earth 3.
What songs are on that? Because I know who they are, but like, I don't know of them that well.
Favorite House Atlantic, that's like their first single that kind of got played on like MTV2 and the radio a little bit. And then there's Three Evils. I I'm not great with track names.
No, because
I just kind of put stuff on and just listen to it. But it's
but that's an album that you listen to from start to finish.
Start to finish every time I catch it. Yeah, because it's the album that I used to put on when I'd be doing all these long road trips doing stand up. I knew how long that album was, and I'm like, okay, I know when I get to this point,
I can put it on. I
put this on,
and I'll get there.
And I'll get right, this when, right it when it ends, and it'll keep me engaged and yeah. Just it's just a fantastic album for me. And then there's some close, you know, seconds. I mean,
well, I wanted to ask because you mentioned your vinyl collection. Yeah. Like, do you have any other favorite records that you have that you listen to?
So one that I really love is Herb Alpert in the Tijuana Brass. So if you've heard his music, you've probably heard it. You just don't know it.
Yeah, yeah.
So he does.
Name's not ringing a bell at all.
I mean, this is from the 60s. Ooh. Like, it's an older genre, but it's. Sounds like a lot of like old game show music, and if you heard, you'd be like, "Oh, I know this," but you didn't know who did it. And the cover is iconic. If you search Herb Alpert and the Tijuana Brass, Whipped Cream and Other Delights, and it's this naked woman covered in whipped cream, and it's like this really sexy album cover that was just
out of the
it was people would buy just for the album cover, yeah. Especially back then, like that was racy as fuck.
Yeah, back in the day, looking at it right now. Holy shit!
And so it's like
she's covered in it, and she's hot.
She's hot as fuck. And the music's all like it's trumpets and like big band kind of stuff. Yeah. But I just love it because that's what I put on when I'm just like cleaning, or like if I have someone over and we're just having drinks.
Yeah, but you don't want it to be quiet.
Yeah, you don't want it to be quiet. Background. You just want some. And like when I go down to the pool, like I put on this. Like it sets a mood. It's fun. It's, you know, you can ignore it, but at the same time, it's in there.
Yeah.
And so that dude's actually coming to town later in September. And so I'm going to go see him live.
Nice.
He's 88 years old, but I'm like, I got to see this guy before he dies.
Yeah, for
so
sure.
I bought tickets the other night. I'm like, that's cool. See this. So that's one that I love. AC/DC Back in Black is just an iconic classic album. I have a few different Blink albums.
I was about to say, I wanted to ask you this. Yesterday, because I love talking to Blink fans.
Yeah.
I really do. Like, it gets my rocks off.
Right.
I talked to this dude yesterday. He was a little bit older, probably about your age. And I asked him, I go, well, what's your, like, he saw I was wearing a Blink t-shirt, the Aliens Exist shirt. Mm-hmm. Like, and he goes, oh, do you, like, what's your, we were talking about it, and I go, what's your favorite album? And he said Cheshire Cat.
Yeah.
And I go, really? Like, I go, that's an early one. Like, I've never heard that out of any fan. Yeah. I mean, I like some of the songs.
There's a few good songs, but it's not a great
album. No, it's not at all. Like, there's a handful of good ones. Yeah. At best.
What they did from Cheshire Cat to
Dude Ranch. Stage,
even Dude Ranch, yeah.
That was light
years apart.
But
my favorite is definitely Enema of the
State. Yeah. Though.
That's just the one that it was just on a loop.
Okay. I had this brain. This is a genius question because fuck, marry, kill.
Yeah.
Enema of the State, Take Off Your Pants and Jacket, self-titled.
Ooh.
Yeah.
All right.
I think I'm marrying self-titled. I think I'm actually going to kill Enema.
Okay.
And I'm fucking Take Off Your Pants and Jacket.
All right.
Because the rock show, that fucks.
Yeah.
You know, I Miss You, that's marriage.
Yeah.
And, like, I love all the deep cuts on Enema of the State. Like, Mutt, Dysentery, Gary, the party song. Anthem is fucking...
Anthem is great. Might be their best song on that album.
I 100% agree. Like, that you don't belong... Like, dude, hits.
Yeah.
So, like, but, I mean, I hate... I don't hate it, but, like, all the small things, like, just can go fuck off.
Well, it's just so overplayed.
Oh, exactly, yeah.
And even like, What's My Age Again, like, we've just heard it so much.
Yeah, I know they're good songs, but the moment, like, it comes on my shuffle, I don't even, like, I don't want to hear it. Like, I'm done.
Yeah, like, I need
I need to cleanse the palate
From these songs. Now, I've kind of done that because, like, I'm not nearly the Blink fan that you are. Like, I'm a big fan, but, like...
Yeah, you definitely are. What do you mean? Nah, I mean, I'm just obsessed. I'm a weirdo.
You live it. So I'm going to go fuck Enema of the State, marry self-titled. Oh, fuck, I can't do that.
You know, it's tough.
It's so tough. I'm going to kill self-titled and marry Take Off Your Pants and Jacket.
Yeah.
Because that is the most replayable one, because that's when they really got to where they
elevated.
That's when they found their balance.
Like Enema was here, Takeoff took them literally took them off,
where they had the humor and the depth,
dark, yes,
with a good balance. That's Take Off Your Pants and Jacket. Enema is real silly with some out of, like, but then Adam's song comes on and you're like, where the fuck did this come from?
I love those My Pet Alien, This Is Adam, yeah, song, and yeah, the aliens crying, or like Stay, yeah, Together for the Kids. Yeah. Like, some of those just are like, ah.
Yeah. So that's the direction I'm gonna go. And yeah, Stay Together for the Kids, such a great song. But also not the best message, because like there's people that like they stay together for the kids, but they fucking hate each other.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, they're assholes.
Yeah, don't do that.
Yeah, like, no, just, right?
Like, I get that you had a tough time with the divorce, Tom. I don't know if it would have been better if they had stayed together.
Yeah, right? Like, come on. Yeah. Oh, that's, yeah, too funny.
I hope you process that.
That just, all right. I think that's the perfect way to end this show.
I love it. This was a blast.
It really was. I'm.
Let me ask you, what's your go-to drink if we do a shot later? Now you're like, cocktail, like if we do a shot, what do you want?
Oh, dealer's choice. I don't say no to anything.
But like, what would yours?
Have you had a Dirty Girl Scout in a while?
I've never even heard of that. What is it?
It's like
sounds great.
Vodka, creme de menthe, and like a chocolate liqueur.
All right.
And it's like got that green, like,
yeah,
you know, thin mint box.
Do you think they'll make that at the Foundry?
I don't know. Let's see if they. I want to make one of those. Like, I'll mix it with Nixon and like, yeah, make a cocktail with it. But yeah, or if not, yeah, like anything. Like, it was funny. I was gonna, before you told me what your drink preference was, which that made my day when, yeah, I saw you said Tito's soda lime.
Yeah,
I was like, this fucking, he fucks. Like, yeah, this is
it's,
my.
It's just a simple drink. It gets you where you need to.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. And you can manage it.
Yeah,
like you know where you're gonna be in control. Like,
right. Yeah.
I can have endless amounts, but no, if like,
right,
especially if there's more mixer, like more soda than two.
Yeah.
Just riding the train.
You start with a double and then you go to singles for, yeah, a while, and then you just kind of take it easy.
I was in my head, I was like, well, if I don't know what this guy likes, I was like, I'm going to make this guy a Vegas bomb. But then he's going to look at me like, this guy's a fucking douchebag. Like, yeah, giving him a Vegas bomb.
I mean, listen, I would drink it.
Yeah, I know you would.
It's not a go-to.
Your thought of me would be like, this guy's a loser.
Also, a Vegas bomb at noon is fucking wild.
Right? Yeah, like, hey, dude, you ready to get the day started? Yeah. Some coke for you, yeah, too, while you're at it. But let's wrap this up. I like I said, I really enjoyed having you over here. You're just a very normal human being.
What day is this coming out,
do you know? I'll probably release this on this upcoming Wednesday.
Okay, all right, because I have an announcement coming up, but it's not till September 18th. So yeah, follow me on social media.
Yeah, I was gonna say,
like, at Bill Squire,
plug your stuff in.
On Instagram, on, you know, just search Bill Squire, you'll find me. Not Billy, just Bill, because then you'll find a old rock star. So find me on there, and then September 18th, I got a big announcement for something that I'm very excited about. Yeah. I'll tell you off air. But,
oh, cool! Yeah. I was about to say, I definitely want to know. But we're going to wrap up this episode of Stay Beautiful America. Thanks so much for watching. I love you guys. Have a good one. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
10 out of 10, dude.
Hell yeah.
You're an awesome human being.